Let's practice finding the derivative as a function. So I'm looking at the right-hand side of the board here, and the directions in this case are to find f prime of x, so that notation means the derivative function, for f of x equals the square root of x. Okay, so the reason I still have all of this work on the left-hand side of the board is that this is a problem we did earlier where we found the slope of the tangent line or the derivative at a single point. So I'm going to kind of parallel this work and show you how similar of a process it is to find the derivative as a function instead. Okay, so let me start by just writing down the definition of the derivative. So we're still going to be using the same limit definition to find the derivative as a function. So what that looks like is f prime of x equals the limit as h goes to 0 of f of x plus h minus f of x all over h. So notice how similar this definition looks to my tangent line at a point definition that I have over here. They're nearly identical, right? Except that instead of finding the tangent line at a specific point at x equals a, I'm finding it for any x in general. So I replace the a by an x in the definition. Okay, so let's work through this. And I'll try and keep the steps kind of lined up with what I did before. Okay, so the first thing we want to do is apply this definition to our specific function, which in this case is the square root of x. So f prime of x is going to be the limit as h goes to 0 of the square root of x plus h. Okay, so f of x plus h means I just take x plus h and plug it in for x in my function. So I get the square root of x plus h minus f of x, which is the square root of x, all over h. Okay, so what did we do last time to solve this problem? We had the same form. We had this difference of square roots in the numerator. And what we did to get around that issue is to multiply by the conjugate on the top and the bottom. And the reason it was an issue is, if you remember, is that if we go ahead and plug in 0 at this point, we get the form 0 over 0. So we have to do some sort of additional algebra. So let's do that again. I'm going to multiply by the conjugate in the top and the bottom. So I have what I had before, square root of x plus h minus square root of x all over h. And I'm going to multiply in the top by the square root of x plus h plus the square root of x, and then by the same thing in the denominator as well. Okay, and then like I did last time, I need to FOIL out that numerator, and that's going to make a lot of things turn out really nicely. So when I multiply the first terms together, okay, so I'm FOILing here, and for my first terms, I get root x plus h times square root x plus h, so the square roots go away, and I'm just left with x plus h. My outer terms give me plus root x times root x plus h, but my inner terms give me minus root x times root x plus h. So those things go away, and then my last terms give me minus square root x times square root x, so that's minus x. Okay, and then in the denominator I have h times the quantity square root x plus h plus square root x. Okay, so we see that the x's in the numerator go away because I have x minus x, so I'm left with the limit as h goes to 0 of h in the top, and in the bottom, still h times the quantity, root x plus h plus root x. Okay, and hopefully you are kind of out of the corner of your eye looking at what we did on the left-hand side. This should look very similar. So now I see that I have a factor of h in the top and in the bottom. I'm going to cancel those out. And once I do that, I'm left with the limit as h goes to 0 of 1 over root x plus h plus root x. Okay, so I've done quite a bit of simplification here. So now what happens if I plug in 0 for h? Well, I no longer get 0 over 0 anymore. I don't get that nasty form. So I'm at a point where I can write down the answer. So remember what we were doing was finding f prime of x. So f prime of x, if I plug in 0 for h, I'm taking the limit as h goes to 0, I get 1 over root x plus root x, which is 1 over 2 root x. And this is the derivative function. Now, compare that to what we had before. Okay, so before we were finding the derivative at the point x equals 5. Okay, so what if I were to evaluate what I just found, the derivative function at 5? Well, I get 1 over 2 root 5, which is exactly what I got before. The nice thing about doing it like this, though, is now I can evaluate at other points without doing really any extra work. So this is how you find the derivatives of functions.